Hello friends, I'm Katrina, and in this video, I'm going to show you how to create a beautiful and mobile-friendly WordPress website step-by-step from scratch. The design of the website we're about to create is perfect for anyone who's looking to build an online presence and a personal brand. Before we dive in, however, I want to quickly mention that I share lots of resources to help you build an online business on my website. That's me on the homepage. So be sure to check out katrinah.com for tools and tutorials that can help you build a profitable online business. Here we are on the homepage of the website we'll be creating in this video using the MK theme by Level 9 Themes. Right out of the gate, we can see that this layout is very different from many of the other themes we see often these days online. So that's one of the things that I really like about this particular theme is that it has a very unique design, which helps it to stand out. So on the left-hand side, we're going to have our title or our logo right here at the top. Then we'll have our menu navigation items on the left sidebar, followed by at the bottom, we have the search button, which when I click on this, a box pops up at the top and you can type whatever you would like to search for here in this box right there. Then on the bottom of this sidebar down below, we have our social network icon so anyone can easily connect with us on the social web. Also on the homepage, front and center, in addition to this large image of you or people in your business, your team, or your products, we also have a title tagline, and this will give your visitors a really clear understanding as soon as they arrive on your website what your website is about and how you can help them. In addition, we're going to have a call to action button right here, which will guide your visitor to whatever next step you'd like them to take. Finally, at the bottom of the homepage here, we're going to be adding an email opt-in form so you can start collecting leads directly from your homepage. So as we see on the left-hand side, I'm going to be adding an about page, services page, a blog archive page, and a contact page. So to take a look at some of the internal pages, I'm going to click on about. And here on the About page, we'll see a banner image at the top followed by the content of our page. In this instance, I've added text as well as an image. And in this video, we're also going to be adding a custom call to action button at the bottom, once again, to direct our visitors to the next step that we'd like them to take. So this is the About page we'll be creating in this video. Now, when I hop over to the Services page, once again, we'll see the same banner image at the top, our content of our page, and again, we have a custom call to action button at the bottom. Then here on the blog archive page, this is one of my favorite pages, mainly because it's so visual. This part is optional. You can include this or remove it. In this case, I've retained the homepage header right here with the title and the call to action. However, when we scroll down, now we'll see all the various blog posts that are included within our website. So it has this really cool hover effect here where the background turns a little darker so we can more easily read the title of the post. And then of course, there's a call to action to read the post. So we can see all our various blog posts right there. So this is our blog archive page. Last but not least, we have our contact page, which when I click on this, as we would expect, this will give us a form that our visitors can fill out to contact us directly from within our website. At the top, once again, we have this custom header image, then we have our form, and here is the send button right here. So this is where we're headed toward in this video. We're going to be creating this really cool and unique WordPress website using the MK theme by Level 9 Themes. This is a responsive, mobile-friendly website, so it's going to look amazing on laptops, tablets, and on any kind of smartphone. So to get a sense of what it will look like on a smaller screen size, when I come to the bottom here and I reduce the screen size, we can see that when I reduce the screen size to a smartphone view, now we have the logo or title on the left-hand corner, and we have this menu icon right here, which when I click on this, it will open up all the different menu items so we can more easily see it within a smartphone view. Then once again, we'll have our main image, our title, and our call to action. And then at the bottom, we have a responsive view of our email opt-in form so that we can capture leads. So this is what's referred to as a mobile-friendly or responsive WordPress website. So this is where we're headed toward in this video. We're going to be creating a professional WordPress website using the MK theme by Level 9 Themes. Let's dive in and get started. So to create this website, we need a few things. Number one, we need a domain name, and number two, we need web hosting. In this video, I'm going to be using hostgator.com for both the domain name as well as the web hosting. So here we are on hostgator.com. First up, we need to click on this yellow button in the middle that says Get Started Now. Once you click on Get Started Now, then you'll arrive on this page where you can choose the web hosting plan that you would like. So when I scroll down, for example, we see that there's three different plans to choose from: Hatchling plan, baby plan, and a business plan. If you're just getting started with your website, most likely you can use the hatchling plan and that should be sufficient. So to keep within my budget for this demo purpose, I'm only going to be hosting one demo website using the hatchling plan. So I'm going to click on sign up now for the hatchling plan. Then I'll arrive on this page and I need to register my new domain name. So right in this box, I'm going to add my new domain name. And once you have the domain name available, then you want to just scroll down to the bottom. Here we see there's domain privacy protection as an option. I always get this because basically what this does is it prevents all of your information, like your email address, your phone number, your address, things like that. It prevents that and hides that from being included in an online database related to your website. So I always think it's a good idea to invest in this, but it's up to you. If you'd like to save some money, then of course you can uncheck it. So decide whatever works best for you, check it or uncheck it, and then we'll move forward. And here we have choose a hosting plan. So we've already chosen the Hatchling plan. I'm going to choose 6 months at a time because that is the best value with the coupon I'm going to share with you in just a moment. Then you add your username, your security PIN, enter your billing info. Then you want to scroll down and we have some more options. These are all optional, so read through these if you'd like. I'm not going to order these, however, so I'm going to uncheck them. And then down below here we see that I have to enter a coupon code. So the coupon code by default is this one right here, but I have a special coupon code which will give you more money off, more of a discount. So it's always good. Everyone always loves to save more money. So I'm going to add that one right here. It's WP coupon 25. We can see we're going from $58 for 6 months of web hosting to, voila, when I click on validate, it goes down to $49. So if you'd like to get an extra amount off of your order, feel free to use my coupon code WPCoupon25. Now, if you don't want to sign up for 6 months at a time, I have another coupon that will give you more of a value for, this is the best coupon for 1 month, for example. So when I come down here, click on billing cycle, 1 month only, so we're going month to month. Then I scroll down to the coupon code. The best coupon when you're signing up for 1 month at a time is 1 month bonus. So I'm going to pop in 1 month bonus coupon code there and click on validate. And now we can see that my total is under $13. Super cool. So choose the one that works best for you, either WP coupon 25 or 1 month bonus. And I do want to note that I do receive a small referral when you use either of my coupons. And thank you so much for your support in helping me to continue to create free WordPress training videos. Okay, so once you have all of that set, you want to review the details of your order, scroll to the bottom, click on this button here that says you have read the terms of service after you've read them, of course, and then click on this yellow button that says check out now. So once you click on create your account, you'll get this page, which will thank you for your order and will tell you to go check your email for information related to logging into your web hosting account. So I'm going to go check out my email. And here we see on my email account, here's the email from HostGator with my account info. So I'm going to click this email to open it. And I want to point out two things. Number one, the first link that they'll share with you in the email is the billing system link. And then right below that, you'll see that there's a link for your control panel with your username and a temporary password. So I'm going to copy this password here, the temporary password, and to log into your control panel, you'll use this link. So I'm going to click on this link here, and then here is my username. You want to type in your username, and then you want to add your password right here as well. Once you have that set up, you want to click on login to log into the control panel of your web hosting account. So here we are in the control panel of our HostGator account. To install WordPress, which is step number two, we need to scroll down to the bottom, and here where it says services, software and services, we want to click on this button here that says quick install. Once we click on quick install, then we want to go to the left-hand side, and here where it says WordPress, we want to click on WordPress. Once we click on WordPress, then we'll see this install WordPress for free section, and then we want to click on this button that says install WordPress. And then here we want to fill out the form to get started with our install. So you just want to choose which website you need right here. And once you filled out the form, then you can click on this button here to install WordPress. Once your WordPress installation is complete, you'll get a message at the top here that says your install is complete. Click here to view your notifications, and you can also view your credentials. So then I'm just going to click on this little caret here to view my credentials, and here we can see I can go directly to the admin area by clicking on this link here, and here's my username and my password. So you just want to copy your password, highlight and copy it, click on this link, and then you can log in to your new WordPress website. So here we are on the WordPress website. This is the first thing that you'll see when you log in to your WordPress website. And at the top, we'll have this welcome message that says, "Welcome to WordPress," with a number of links to get you started. I'm going to be going over each of these links later on in the video, so I'm not going to cover these now, but I just want to point these out. Okay, so let's take a look at our website when we first install WordPress using the 2015 theme. To view the site, you want to go up to your name or your website name at the top left-hand corner, hover over the website name, and click on Visit Site. Here we'll see the home page of our website using the 2015 theme. And in a previous video, I walked you step by step from scratch showing you how to set up this website using the 2015 theme. In this video, however, we're going to be using the MK theme, which when I pop on over to my completed site, this is what our website is going to look like when we're completed with this video. So we've got quite a bit of work to do, and first thing we need to do is we need to change the theme from 2015 to the MK theme. So let's do that now. To change the theme, you want to go back to your dashboard by hovering over the website name once again and clicking on Dashboard. Then here on the left-hand side, you'll see all these different menu items. We want to go to Appearance, hover over Appearance, and click on Themes. Here on the Themes panel, we can see a number of themes that have come pre-installed with our WordPress installation, as well as a few that I added behind the scenes, but the one that we're going to be adding right now is called the MK theme. So here on the left-hand side, we see that the 2015 theme is currently active. To add the MK theme, I'm going to go up to the top, click on Add New, and here we'll see a number of different themes that are included within the WordPress theme library. You can check out all of these and check them out one by one if you'd like, but the one we're going to be adding now is called MK. So I'm going to put MK in the search box, and then here we see it shows up here on the left-hand side. And when I hover on top of this image, we can see we can check out the details and preview the theme, or we can simply install it. I'm going to install it by simply clicking on Install. And once a theme has been successfully installed, we're going to activate it by clicking on Activate. Okay, so now the new active theme for our WordPress website is the MK theme. Awesome. We can visit it by clicking on this link here that says Visit Site, or once again, we can go up to the website name on the top left-hand corner and click on Visit Site. So here we are on the homepage of our WordPress website using the new MK theme that we just installed, and we can see that we have quite a bit of work to do because when we pop on over to the finished site, here we see at the top we have our logo as well as our menu items, we have an image in the background, our tagline, a call to action button, and then down below we have our email opt-in form where we can start to capture leads directly from within our website. So let's take care of the first customizations, which include customizing our logo and adding some menu items on the left-hand side. Now, most of the customizations we're going to be making on this theme will take place in the Customize panel, which you can find by going back to the website. Here at the top, there's a toolbar and it says Customize. You can either click on that or you can go to Dashboard by clicking on Dashboard, then going down to Appearance, hovering over Appearance, and clicking on Customize.
Now, I want to make one special note though. Most of the customizations we'll be making in this theme will be taking place within this customized panel. However, we will be making a few modifications to the styles here, and to do that, we're going to be needing a child theme. So in a previous video, I walked you step by step from scratch showing you how to set up a child theme. I'm going to go more quickly through the steps right now, but if you want to see the other tutorial on how to create a really simple and easy child theme, be sure to check out my other video, and I'll be sure to drop a link below. For now, I'm going to close this box and I'm going to go back to the dashboard. Here we are on the dashboard. Then I'm going to go down to plugins, hover over plugins, and click on add new. Here on the plugins page, we can see all the plugins available within the WordPress plugin library, and the one that I want right now is called Child Themify. So I'm going to do a search for Child Themify. Here's the plugin on the left-hand side, Child Themify. We can see it has over 10,000 installs and close to a 5-star rating. So I'm going to install it by clicking on Install Now, and then I'm going to click on Activate. And once a plugin has been activated, we'll see it showing up here in our plugins directory of all the plugins we have on our site. So now to create the child theme, I'm going to go to Appearance, hover over Appearance, and click on Themes. Then here's our active theme, MK. I'm going to click on Theme Details, and at the bottom it says Create a Child Theme, so I'm going to click on this button. Then I'm going to give my new child theme a name, and once I've added the name, I'm going to click on this button that says Let's Go. Okay, the child theme was successfully created. Awesome. Now that our child theme has been successfully created, there's one more step that we need to take to make this all work, and that is we need to actually activate the child theme we just created. So to activate our theme, we're going to go back to Themes by hovering over Appearance and clicking on Themes. Then here in the theme panel, here we can see our active theme is the parent theme, MK, and down below, MK theme, this is our child theme. So this is the one we need to activate by clicking on Activate. Once you activate the child theme, then you're free to make customizations directly to the child theme, knowing that any changes you make will be protected when there's a theme update. For now, let's take a look at the Customize panel by going over to Appearance and clicking on Customize. Here on the right-hand side, you'll see a preview pane of what the website looks like now, and as we make modifications in the Customize panel, you'll see what those iterations are looking like here in the preview panel. So starting with the site identity at the top, I'm going to click on that. Here you can give your website a site title as well as a tagline, and you can choose whether or not you want to display the header text. In this video tutorial, I'm simply going to give my site a title, I'm not going to add a tagline, and I'm not going to display the header text. We'll see why in a moment, namely because I'm going to be adding a custom logo instead. Here where it says site icon, if you'd like to add a site icon, you can do that as well. Note that the icons must be square, as it notes right here, and at least 512 pixels wide and tall. I'm not going to add a site icon, I'm simply going to add a site title, then I'm going to click on Save and Publish to save my changes. Once the changes have been made, then I'm going to go back to the Customizer panel by clicking on this back button. Next up, we have our General Settings. When I click on General Settings, here at the top, we see we can add a custom logo as well as a favicon, and we can adjust the blog index layout as well as these other options down below. So starting with the logo, I'm going to click on Select File and choose my logo. I don't have one yet here in the media library because I haven't really added anything to this site. So to upload a file, I'm going to click on Upload File and Select Files. Then I'll select my file, and at the bottom, I'll click on Open to add this image to my WordPress website. Once the image has been uploaded to my WordPress website, we'll see the attachment details here on the right-hand side, and I can give this image a title as well as an alternative text. Once you've added a title and alternative text, come to the bottom and click on Choose File to choose the file. Once you've added the logo, go ahead and click on Save and Publish to save your changes. Now note that here we can sort of see the logo, but it's a black font on a black background, and we'll be changing that in a few moments. Right now, I want to continue with the rest of the options within the General Settings panel, starting with the favicon. So favicon is a small icon that represents your website and follows your site around the web. So as a quick example, when we jump over to youtube.com, we can see here are a number of favicons that represent these different sites. We have the orange circle circle or red circle for Google+, the Twitter bird, and then we have the Facebook blue circle. They're really small little icons that represent each one of these sites. So I'm not going to be adding a favicon in this website tutorial, but if you want to create one for your website, you can simply do a Google search for favicon, and there's all kinds of favicon generators that you can use to create a favicon for your website. Once you've created the favicon, you can upload it to your site by selecting the file right here. Okay, next up though, within the customize panel, I want to change the blog index layout. So we can see with the MK Lite theme, when I click on this, there's two different options for our WordPress website blog, namely a classic layout or a grid layout. I want the grid layout, so I'm going to click on grid. And then here down below, there's two more options. If we want header search, which here we can see the search button right here. And then if we want to add a custom header image section, we can do so right here. I'll be covering this in just a few moments, but we do need to activate it by making sure that it's checked. So I've checked both of these boxes. Then at the top, I'm going to click on Save and Publish to save my changes. Next, going back to the Customize panel, I'm going to click on the back button here, going down to the Homepage slider. So this is the fun part because this is where we can add the image to the main page of our WordPress website. So here we see Homepage slider. I'm going to click on that one more time. And here are all the settings that we can adjust for the image slider. So note that when I pop on over to the finished site, here I have my image slider right here. Back on the Customize panel for the Homepage slider, first up we have the slider button style options. So when I click on this, here we see there's a number of different button styles we can choose. I'm going to go with the default version. All of these correspond to a different color for the button. So feel free to experiment, and whatever works best for your brand and your website, choose that one. I'm going to choose default by clicking on default. And then next up, here we have the slides mask color, and this corresponds to the color on top of the image on the website. So when I pop on over to the finished site, we can see there's a kind of mask here on top of this image that is darkening it just a little bit. So that's what we're referring to right now, is the mask. So the cool thing with this mask is that you can actually choose a color that matches your brand and matches the image that you're using. So for example, if you're using an image that has a lot of trees and foliage and plants in it, you might want to choose the green mask color like that. I'm going to choose the dark color, so I'm going to choose the black mask color right here. And it's always fun, once again, to experiment and see what color will work best for your website. Okay, so now that I have the black color, then I'm going to move down to the slide mask opacity, and I'm going to leave it as it is for the moment. For the slider speed, I like to slow it down so it's a really slow slider. So I'm going to set it to the far right-hand side. Then here we have two more options. If you want to show the default homepage slider, you can do so by checking on that. And if you want to show the default homepage slider on the blog page, you can do so by clicking on this box here. I definitely want to show the same image on the blog page, so I'm going to click on both of these two. Next, moving down to the slider content source, here we see when I click on this, we can either choose latest post or custom slides. I'm going to choose custom slides by just leaving it set to custom slide. Then I'm going to scroll down, and this is where we can change our image. So as we see on my finished site, I really just have one main image here and it doesn't really change. That's because I personally prefer not to have a slider effect. I don't like things moving on my website. However, you may want to have some sliders here for different images and different taglines and call to actions. So I'll show you in this video how to both create a static image as well as a rotating slider image. Note down below that there's these two buttons right here, and actually they're the same exact image with the same tagline and button. That is how I create this effect that makes it look like nothing is moving and there's no slider. So for example, when we go back to the customize panel here, first up we want to change our image to whatever image you want to have displayed on the homepage. So I'm going to click on change file to change my file, then upload file and select file, and then I'm going to choose my image. Here's the image at the top. I'm going to select it and click on open, and as we did with the previous image, I'm going to give my new image both a title and an alternative text. Once you've added the title and alternative text, click on Choose File to choose your file. Okay, next up we have our slide main caption, subcaption, the button URL, the button text. Four things we need to add. In this demo website, I'm going to be using the main caption, but I'm not going to be adding a subcaption. So it's really up to you if you'd like to add that or not. I'm going to remove it by just deleting it right there. And then I'm going to give my button URL where I want this button to link to. And then I'll leave the button text as learn more. So here on the right-hand side, we can see a preview of what this may look like. Here we have my main caption, and then we have my button. And when I click on this, this will lead to my services page. Now we haven't yet created the services page, but I know that the website URL is going to be services. So I'll make a note of that mentally right now, and we'll circle back once we create the services page a little bit later in this video. Okay, next up, when I scroll down, I'm also going to replace slider 2 image with the same image by clicking on Change File. Then I'm going to choose my file and click on Choose File. You can also at this point upload a different image if you'd like by clicking on Upload File and selecting your file. I'm going to choose the same image so that I have a kind of static effect on the home page without a revolving image. Okay, so I have my image here. I'm going to click on Choose File. And then as I did in the previous version right here, I'm going to do the same thing with the same caption, the same URL, and the same button text. Once again, this is so that I don't have that slider effect happening. If you want a slider effect, by all means, change your caption, your URL, and your button text. Okay, once you have your two images here, you can add more images if you like. However, I'm going to remove them because I don't want them to be displayed, so I'm simply going to click on Remove. Then I'm going to remove all the default info that comes with the theme. So I'm just going to remove all of that and remove this one right here. Let's see if anything else is lingering. There we go. So I've removed all the content for the third, fourth, and fifth image. And I only have two images right now, and they both have the same image, the same caption, same button URL, and same button text. Okay, then I'm going to click on Save and Publish to save my changes. Once the changes have been saved within the customized panel, we can go back by clicking on the back button, then clicking on it one more time, and next up we have our social links. So clicking on social links, here we can add all the social links that we'd like to have displayed down here on this main navigation area. So for this particular example, I only want Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram to be displayed, so I'm going to add my URL for each one of those social networks. Okay, so once we've added the URLs of our social networks here on the left-hand side, we can see in the preview pane these new icons showing up down below. Awesome. Next, I'm going to save my changes by clicking on Save and Publish. Going back, I'm going to click on the back button two times, and here we are back on the customize panel where I can change the colors and typography next. So clicking on that, here we see we have the primary font options and the header font options, as well as the body text color, links color, and the links hover color. So for the primary font, I'm going to leave the default as Open Sans. When you click on this, you'll see there's all these different Google fonts that you can choose from, which is really awesome. So choose the font that works best for your website. I'm going to leave it as Open Sans. For the header font, I'm going to change that to the Dosis font by just scrolling up here and choosing Dosis. Again, choose whatever font works best for your website. For body text color, I'm going to click on Select a Color, and here you can select whatever color you like. I'm going to leave the body text color as it is with these six numbers right in there. And then moving on to the links color, I am going to adjust this because we note that here on the left-hand side, when I hover over this particular item, it turns this kind of turquoise green color, this teal color. So I want to match the links to this color as well. So here for links, I'm going to click on Select a Color, and then I'm going to pop in the same teal color right there, and I'm going to do the same for the links hover color. Once again, for your website and your brand, choose whatever color complements your brand. Once you have the changes set, go ahead and click on Save and Publish to save your changes. Once the changes have been saved, we're going to go back to the Customize panel by clicking on the Back button. Then we're going to go down to Header Image and click on Header Image. Here within the Customize panel for the header image, there's a short note at the top recommending that the header size be or have the dimensions of 1280 pixels wide and 280 pixels tall. So here I'm just going to add a new image by clicking on Add New Image. Then I'm going to select my file by clicking on Upload File and Select File. Then I'll choose my file and click on Open. Once the image has been uploaded to WordPress, we'll see the attachment details in the top right-hand corner. And then I'm going to add my title as well as an alternative text. Once you've added the title and alternative text, click on Select and Crop to select your image. Here you can crop your image, but once again, I recommend that you create an image before you upload it that has the proper dimensions. So I'm just going to leave it as it is and click on Skip Cropping because it's already set to 1280 by 280. Okay, so once you have your header image added to the Customize panel here, you can click on Save and Publish to save your changes. If you'd like to add a variety of headers and have them randomized across all of your internal pages, you can add more internal banners here by clicking on Add New Image. Once a header image has been added within the Customize panel, you can save your changes by clicking on Save and Publish. Also, I want to note that if you'd like to have a variety of header images being displayed within the internal pages of your website, you can add additional headers by simply clicking on Add New Image. So for example, when I click on Add New Image and once again click on Upload File and Select File, then I'll choose my file and click on Open down below, then I'll add my title and alternative text. And once I've added the title and alternative text, I can click on Select and Crop to select my image. Then I'll click on either Crop Image or Skip Cropping. Then we'll see the second image being displayed right here. So if you would like to randomize your uploaded headers, you can do so by simply clicking on this button right here, and then your internal pages will display randomly either this image, or any other images you upload. So I'm just simply going to leave it like that and then click on Randomize Uploaded Headers and click on Save and Publish to save my changes. Then to go back, I'm going to click on the Back button here. Next up are the menu settings. So when I click on Menus here within the Customize panel, we can see there's a variety of different options that we can set related to the menu, both the menu locations as well as the actual menu pages. You can either do so within the Customize panel, or what I prefer to do is go directly to the Menus page itself. So to do that, I'm going to close this out, and then I'm going to go back to the WordPress dashboard. Here on the dashboard, I'm going to go down to Appearance, hover over Appearance, and click on Menu. So we see here, when I installed WordPress, it came with a built-in menu in these two pages, the home page and the sample page. If you don't see this and you don't see any menu, then what you need to do is create a new menu by clicking on this link here that says Create a New Menu. Then you want to give your new menu a name by filling in the name here. And then you want to click on this blue button that says Create a Menu. Once you have your new menu set, then you want to add some pages to your menu. So for example, the only page we have now, since we haven't created any pages, is the sample page that came with our WordPress installation. So I'm simply going to click on this, and then I'll click on Add to Menu to add my sample page to the menu. Once your pages are added to the menu, next up we need to set the location of the menu, and you can do so by either clicking on one of these links down below where it says Menu Settings and Theme Locations. You can click on Primary Menu right here, then click on Save Menu, or you can do the same thing by going up to this location tab right here, clicking on Manage Locations, and then you'll see at the top you can set the location here as well. Since we've already set it in the previous panel, it shows up right here. Then you want to click on Save Changes to save your changes. So let's take a quick look at the home page to see what our website is looking like so far. Going up to the top, I'm going to hover over the website name and click on Visit Site. So here we are on the home page of our WordPress website, and this is what it looks like so far. It's coming along, but we still have quite a few more changes to make in order for it to look like the finished website, which is this version over here. We can see, for example, that this mask that is on top of this image is a little bit lighter than the current one that we have right here. So next up, I want to just adjust the mask so it's a little bit lighter. So adjust the mask, I'm gonna go up to customize, click on customize. Then I'm gonna go down to homepage slider and then click on homepage slider. And here where it says slide mask opacity, I'm just gonna move that down just a tad to make that a little bit lighter. Then I'm gonna click on save and publish to save my changes. Okay, next up, we scroll down here and we can see we have all this footer stuff here, and I prefer to keep it really clean. If you'd like to add custom content within the footer, I'll definitely show you how to do so, but for this particular demo website, I'm going to remove all this so that it's a really clean, minimalist style. So going back to the customize panel, I'm going to click the back button right here 2 times, then going down to widgets. Here we can see, here's all the info for the footer widgets. You can either customize that here within the customize panel by clicking each one of these, or what I prefer to do is close this out altogether, then go back to the WordPress dashboard by clicking on dashboard. And here on the dashboard, I prefer to see my widgets within the actual widget page. So going down to appearance, I'm gonna hover over appearance and click on widgets. And now I have a much larger version. It's a lot easier to see my widgets in this screen instead. So these are all the widgets that come built in with your WordPress installation, and you can either keep them or what I prefer to do is remove them all together. So to remove them, you simply want to click on each one of them and you can click on delete, or you can simply slide them to the left to remove them from the lineup here within the footer left section. So I'm just dragging them over to remove them. Here we have the footer middle as well as the footer right. So I'm gonna remove the search one as well by just dragging that over. If you'd like to add custom content within the footer section, then this is how you would do it. You would simply grab whatever content you want right here. If you did want, for example, the search button, you would just grab that. And you would drag it up into the footer left section or the middle section or the right section or wherever you'd like to have it displayed. You can do the same thing with all this other content as well by simply dragging it to wherever you'd like to have it displayed. So to keep the footer section really clean, I'm not going to add any content in the footer section, but of course, feel free to add any content you would like to customize the footer section. Next up, let's add some new pages to our WordPress website by either going up to the top, hovering over plus new and clicking on page, or on the left-hand sidebar, you can go to pages, hover over pages and click on add new. When I click on add new, first up, we need to add a title for our page. So the first page I want to create here is the about page. So I'm going to type in about. Then here in this white section, we can add our content. So note that there's all these formatting icons up above. This is similar to a Word document or to an email. You can use all of these icons to format your text without knowing any code, which is really awesome. Also note that there's this toggle toolbar right here, which when I click on that, it opens up another row of additional formatting icons. So just like an email or a Word document, you want to add your content in this white box. And then you can format it by simply highlighting anything, and then you want to click on one of these formatting options. Okay, so in addition to adding the text here, I also want to add an image. So to add an image to my page, I'm going to place the cursor where I want the image to be displayed. Then I'm going to click on Add Media, and then Upload File, and Select File. Then I'm going to choose my file. So here's my file right here. Then I'm gonna click on open to open the file. And as we did in the previous examples, I wanna give my new image a title as well as an alternative text. Once you've added a title and alternative text, then you can scroll down and check out the attachment display settings. So for example, for the alignment, I want to right align this. So I'm gonna click on right. I wanna link this to nothing. So I'm gonna click on none. Then for the size, you can choose whatever size you'd like for your image. I'm gonna go with the medium size here. Then I'm gonna click on insert into page to insert my image into the page. Actually, this looks a little bit small, so I'm gonna adjust that one more time by clicking on it. You can edit directly by just highlighting it, and then you get these formatting options open. I'm gonna click on edit to edit the image, and here where it says size, I'm gonna choose the full size. Then I'm going to click on update to update my image. Okay, so then I'm going to scroll down to the bottom. Everything looks good. Now I'm going to scroll up to the top and click on Publish to publish my new page. Once the About page has been created, the other page I want to create is the blog page. To create the blog page, once again, I'm going to click on Add New. Then I'm going to give my new blog page a title. Right here where it says Enter Title, I'll call this Blog. And then on the right-hand side where it says Template, I'm going to click on Default Template and choose Page Wide. And I'm not going to add any content in here at all because this is actually the blog archive page. This will be the page where all of the blog single posts are listed on one page. So I'm simply going to click on Publish to publish this page. Next, I want to add a home page because I want to set a static home page. So to do that, once again, I'm going to click on Add New. Then for the page title, I'm going to give this a title of home page since this will be the home page. And that's all I'm going to do. Just add a home title right there. Then I'm going to click on Publish to publish the home page. Finally, I want to add a services page to my website. So once again, I'm going to click on Add New. Then for the title, I'm going to call this Services. And once again, here in the white box, I'm going to add my content. Note that I'm going to format the titles by changing them from a paragraph formatting to, I'll try a header 3 to make them stand out. And once I've adjusted the formatting for my content, then on the right-hand side, I'm going to click on Publish to publish my new page. Okay, so once we have our page created, now let's take a look at our menu section because we have quite a few pages that we can now add to our menu. So going over to the left-hand side, I'm going to hover over Appearance, and then I'm going to click on Menus. And here on the Menu page, we can now add our pages to our menu. So I'm going to add all of these by checking them one by one. We have the Services, Home, Blog, and About page. Then I'm going to click on Add to Menu to add these to the menu. Meanwhile, I no longer need the sample page, so I'm going to delete that by opening it up. Then here it says Remove. I'm going to remove it. Then to display the items how you would like and sort them differently, you can simply drag them up or down however you want each of these things to be displayed. So I'll just leave it like that. Then you want to click on Save Menu to save your menu. Next up, we need to create a static page for our home page and set the blog page. So to do that, I'm going to go over to Settings, hover over Settings, and go to Reading to go to the Reading Settings. Here on the Reading Settings page, we can see the front page displays currently is set to Your Latest Posts. I want to change that to a static page by clicking on Static. Then for the front page, I'm going to choose the home page. And for the post page, I'm going to choose the blog page. Also, you can choose how many posts you want to have displayed within the blog archive page, and the default is set to 10. But I'm going to change that to 4. Feel free to adjust this to whatever number of blog posts you want to have displayed on your blog archive page. When you're ready, scroll down to the bottom and click on Save Changes to save your changes. Okay, now let's take a look at the website by going up to the top and clicking on Visit Site. Now we'll see on the left-hand side we have our homepage, about page, services, and blog page all showing up within the menu navigation. That looks really good. We have our title here and our call to action. Then we have all this white space that we need to reduce. And this is a really quick fix, so let's do that now. Going up to the top, I'm going to click on Edit Page. And here on the home page, we need to set the page template. So on the right-hand side, we see that there's a template. Go ahead and click on that, click on Page Wide, and also keeping in mind this is the home page. Then we're going to click on Update. That will remove the white space from the home page. So now we go back to the home page by clicking on View Page. Now we'll see on the home page when I scroll down, most of that white box has been removed. The only white bar we have right here is related to some extra padding or margin. In this section, however, I want to add an email opt-in form, and that will take care of the white space. So for example, when I pop on over to my finished site, here we'll see at the bottom, underneath the image slider, we have this email opt-in form so we can start to capture leads directly from our home page. So next up, I'm going to add this email opt-in form to our WordPress website. If you've been following along my videos, you know that in a previous video, I walked you step-by-step from scratch showing you how to completely set up an email opt-in form using the Magic Action Box plugin for WordPress. So behind the scenes, I'm going to be adding this email opt-in form following the steps in that video. I'll be sure to drop the video down below so you can also walk through the steps of watching this video and implementing the magic action box. This video, once again, will show you exactly how to create this really cool email opt-in form for your blog post as well as for the home page. I'll see you on the other side once I've added this email opt-in form. So here we are back on the homepage of my WordPress website, and I just finished adding this email opt-in form following the steps in my other YouTube video. As we can see from the homepage, everything looks really good. We're pretty much ready to go. In fact, if you prefer this dark kind of elegant look with the dark sidebar and the dark footer, with the exception of simply swapping out the logo so that the font can be more easily read, so instead of having a black font on a black background, perhaps you have a white font logo on a white background. If you did have a different logo, this website would be good to go. I'm going to continue though, because I want to continue customizing just a few things on this website to kind of pull it all together. So once again, the finished look that we're going for is going from this version to this version here with a white sidebar and a white footer. Also, I'm just going to make a simple change to the font for this title here as well as for these items. Then we'll be good to go. So let's continue with the customization of the white sidebar and the white footer. So to change the color here on the sidebar, we're going to be using the developer tools within the Google Chrome browser. So to follow along, you'll need to be using Google Chrome as well. Within the Google Chrome browser, at the top right-hand corner, we have these three lines, which when I click on this, it will open up a drop-down box. And then I can see there are more tools right here. So I hover over more tools. Then we see here are the developer tools. When I click on developer tools, this will open up a window that will show us all the code that's being used to generate this website. On the left-hand side, we'll see all the HTML code that is responsible for the layout of the website and the structure. And on the right-hand side, we'll see all the CSS styles that are responsible for the display and the appearance of this website. So we need to find the code that is responsible for this dark brown or black sidebar. So here we see right at the top that we are on the body right here, the body class right here, and we can see on the right hand side this background color shows this dark color. So this is one piece of the code that we need to adjust. When I click on this, for example, and then I put in a white color by using the pound and then I'm going to add 6 Fs, now we see that part of this will change to be white, which is great. And then down below, we still need to work on the footer. But for the sidebar, this is one piece. Now there's also this additional navigation section we also need to change. So there's two parts here to actually adjust. But the first one we need to adjust is the body section right here. So I'm simply going to highlight this code on the right-hand side that I just changed, body background color. I'm going to highlight and copy that because any changes we make here within this Inspect Elements developer tool is kind of like a sandbox. It's not really saved within the website until we actually go into the code of the website and save it. So here you can safely play around and change whatever you want and see what happens and know that your website will not yet be affected. So, okay, we need to highlight and copy this code, close this box, then we're going to go back to the dashboard by clicking on Dashboard. Then I'm going to go down to Appearance and Editor to open up the Child Theme Style Sheet. Earlier in this video, we created a child theme, and now we're going to be using this Child Theme Style Sheet to save our changes. So I'm just going to paste the code that I just copied in the previous step, making sure that I close it off with a closing bracket. Then I'm going to click on Update File to update my file. Also note that sometimes the code is not really saved for some reason. It's still being overwritten by the original parent theme style. So in order to mitigate that, I'm going to cut to the chase, and I'm also going to add an extra little clip of code here, the important tag, and essentially what this will do is it will override anything else on the parent style sheet that is trying to be displayed. So this really kind of forces our code to be recognized within the theme. Okay, so now I'm going to click on Update File to update my file. Let's check out the homepage now. When I go up to the top and click on Visit Site, Voila, now we see that part, at least, of the sidebar is white. We still have to finish this other section, this navigation section, and make sure that that is white as well. So once again, we are going to be using the developer tool within the Google Chrome browser. Now there's another way, a faster way, to open up the developer tool. Instead of going to these three lines right here and digging and trying to find the code, we can cut to the chase and simply hover over the section we want to change, hold down the control key and the mouse, and then you'll get this window that opens. If you're on a PC, I believe it's right click, and then you'll see there's an inspect element option. This will bring us directly to the code that we need to customize. So here we see it is right here, this MK header branding, and when I go up just a tad, there we go, to the navbar default code. I'm hovering over it here. We can see the whole section is being highlighted, so we know we're in the right spot. Then on the right-hand side, we'll see here is the code that's generating that dark background, navbar-default, and here's the background code with this number 2 hex code for the color. So I'm going to override that by clicking on that in there, adding a pound sign and 6 Fs for the white color. So now we see everything on the left-hand side is white, except of course for the line that we are hovering on top of, and we'll take care of that a little bit later. For now, let's copy this code that we just customized, highlight it and copy it. Then I'm going to close this box, go back to the dashboard by clicking on Dashboard. Then I'm going to go down to Appearance and Editor. And as we did in the previous example, I'm going to paste the code that I just copied in the previous step, making sure that I also add the important tag to make sure that this new code is definitely recognized. Then I'm going to click on Update File to update my file. Now going back to our site by going up to the top and clicking on Visit Site, here we see on the homepage that now the sidebar is all white, which is great. Now the next thing that I want to change is I want to change the active menu navigation link right here to also be white. So once again, I'm going to hold down the control key on my Mac and click on the mouse, open up this box, and then click on Inspect Element. Then I'm going to choose the code that is related to this active link right here, which we see on the right-hand side. Let's see, here it is right here. Actually, when I click on the A, there we go. So once again, we can see when I click on the code here, note that it highlights on the left-hand side so we know where we're at. Also note that on the right-hand side, it goes directly to the code here. We see the background color is dark. So when I change this #222 number to pound and then 6 Fs, now we see the background is also white for the active link. So next up, I need to just copy this, highlight and copy this code, close the box, go back to the dashboard by clicking on Dashboard, go down to Appearance, hover over Appearance and click on Editor. Then I'm going to paste the code that I just copied in the previous step, making sure once again that I'm just going to grab this important tag and I'm going to add that to the end. Then I'm going to click on Update File to update my file. So now when we go back to the home page by going up to the top and clicking on Visit Site, now we'll see that the entire sidebar is white, which is exactly what I like. There is one little glitch though. Note that when I hover on top of the home link here, it kind of goes white on white, so now we can't read it, so that's not good. So let's adjust that right now as well. I'm going to hover on top of this home link, hold down the control key once again, then click my mouse, open up Inspect Elements, and now we'll see the code that is generating the white color. We need to change that to the same color as the rest of the items, which are a kind of gray color there. So here we see it right here. Here is the item. However, this is the active item. So when you're looking at this code here on the left-hand side, I'm going to hover on top of this code. Let me collapse this so you can kind of hone in and focus on exactly what I'm doing here. So here is the code right here. I'm going to hold down the control key as I'm hovering on top of this and click on the mouse, which will open up another window, which will say force element state. And this time I'm going to choose the hover effect. And now we'll see on the right-hand side, we'll have an extra amount number of code here, extra code here related to the hover effect. And here we can see that the color for the hover color is white, which isn't good. We want to have it be gray like everything else. So I'm going to click on this, then I'm going to change it to gray. There we go. I think that's the same color. Let's see. Actually, what color is this? to check out this color. Let's see, this color is 939393. Okay, so we need this color instead. So I'm just going to highlight it and copy it. Go back to the hover color over here. There we go. Then I'm going to pop that in, and now it matches the rest of all of the other navigation links as well. So this is the color that we need, #939393. I'm going to highlight all of this code, highlight and copy it, close the box, go back to the dashboard, hover on Appearance, click on Editor. Then I'm going to drop the code, paste the code that I just copied in the previous step. Here it is right here. Note that I did not change the background color, so I'm going to remove that. The only thing I changed was the actual font color right here. Then I'm going to grab the important tag just to make sure that this goes into effect, paste that in, and now we're good to go. Then I'm going to click on Update File to update my file. So now when we go back to the homepage by going up to the top and clicking on Visit Site, now we'll note that not only do we have a white sidebar, but the active link right here, we can see it. It looks the same as all the other items down below. Awesome. So next up, if you'd like to change the footer down below, you can do so, or you can leave it black. It looks good both ways, in my opinion, but I'm gonna change it to be white. So once again, I'm gonna hover over this footer section right here. On my Mac, hold down the Control key and click my mouse. Then I'm gonna click on Inspect Elements, open up the Developer Tools, and here on the right-hand side, we can see the background is this dark color. So I'm going to override that by adding my white color, which once again is pound and six Fs. And now we see that the footer section is white. Awesome. So now we need to highlight and copy this code. Close the box. We're getting the hang of this. Go to the dashboard by clicking on Dashboard. Then go down to Appearance and Editor. And here in the Child Theme Style Sheet, I'm going to paste the code I just copied in the previous step, making sure that I finish it off with a closing bracket, and for good measure, I'm going to highlight and copy the important code and add that to my code as well to make sure that this code is kind of listened to and is followed. Okay, then I'm gonna click on Update File to update my file. Okay, let's check out the site. Going up to the top and clicking on Visit Site, and here we are. Now we scroll to the bottom and our footer is white. Awesome. So last but not least, I want to change the font text right here so it has a little bit more creative font. This actually is a really lovely font just as it is, but if you want to kind of spice it up a bit, we can do so. So once again, I'm going to hover on top of this text, hold down the Control key on my Mac, then click my mouse, open up Inspect Elements, and here we see the H2 class tag right here on the left-hand side, and on the right-hand side, we see that the main caption is currently using the Open Sans Lite font. So I want to change that to the Dosis font, so I'm just going to override all of this right here and type in Dosis. Dosis is a Google font, so that looks good. I'm just going to highlight and copy all of this code right here. Highlight it and copy it. Close this box, and here we can see what it's going to look like on this slider right here. It looks pretty cool. Then I'm going to go back to the dashboard by clicking on Dashboard, going down to Appearance, then clicking on Editor, and I'm going to paste the code that I just copied in the previous step, making sure once again that we close everything off with a closing bracket. Now keep in mind that I only changed the font family to Dosis. I didn't change any of this other stuff, so I'm going to remove all that so that we only have the code that we are changing. I'm also going to add, as we did previously, this important tag like so, and then I'll click on Update File to update my file. Okay, so to check out the site, I'm gonna go up to the top and click on Visit Site, and now we see our title being displayed with this cool new font. Okay, next up, let's change the button so that it complements the title above. To change the button, once again, I'm gonna hold down the Control key on my Mac and click on my mouse, open up Inspect Elements, and here we can see the HTML code that's generating the button, and then on the right-hand side, we can see the styles that are generating the button styles. So for example, we have the BTN for button-default. The background color is black. We have a background color. The font color, I should say, is black. The background color is white, and we have a border color of gray. So this is what we need to change. First up, the color. Actually, let's change the background color first. Instead of a background color of white, I want the background color to be transparent or no background whatsoever. So I'm going to override background color and simply add in background. Then instead of the white color there with the pound and three Fs, I'm going to write none. So now we can see there's a transparent button to this kind of display right here. Now we can't read the words though, because they're black on this dark image. So I'm going to change the color of the font itself from #333 to white. There we go. And also the border color, I'm also going to change that to white to keep it consistent. And I'd also like to change the font family so that the font is the same font as the title above. So we're going to add a font family tag in here. And last but not least, I want to change the size of this font so it's a little bit larger, easier to read. So that's the font size tag. And let's try 30. Let's see what that looks like. Okay, so we see that font size doesn't do anything here, so actually I have it in the wrong spot, so I'm going to uncheck that. We'll come back to the size in just a moment. For the moment, I'm going to highlight all of this other code that we've changed, however, highlight it and copy it. Then I'll close Inspect Elements, go back to the dashboard by clicking on Dashboard. Then I'm going to go down to Appearance and Editor and paste the code that I just copied in the previous step. Okay, and note that I've added the important tag to each one of these elements. Then I'm going to click on Update File to update my file. Now we take a look at that button on the homepage by going up to the top and clicking on Visit Site. Now we can see the button has the changes that we've made. I do want to make this font a little bit larger though so that the font is easier to read and larger. So once again, holding down the Control key on my Mac and holding down the mouse, then I'm going to open up Inspect Elements and find the font size for this particular button. Okay, so here we see on the right-hand side, we see it's the button-lg, button large, and we see the font size is currently 18 pixels. I'm going to raise that to about 26 pixels, and that looks a lot better. We can see that so much better when it's 26 pixels. So I'm going to highlight this code, highlight it, and copy it. Then close Inspect Elements, go back to the dashboard by clicking on Dashboard, go down to Appearance and Editor, and here at the bottom, I'm going to paste in the code that I just copied in the previous step, adding an important tag and clicking on Update File. So now taking a look at our website, I'm going to go up to the top and click on Visit Site. And now we see the larger button being displayed on the slider. Awesome. So next up, I want to customize these fonts here on the left-hand sidebar. And now we see the larger button being displayed here on the slider. Awesome. So next up, I just want to adjust some of these styles here for these navigational items so they're a little bit larger and we can see them a little bit better. So once again, I'm going to open up Inspect Elements by holding down the Control key on my Mac and clicking on the mouse. Then I'm going to click on Inspect Element to go directly to this code. Here we see the HTML on the left-hand side, and on the right side, here we can see the CSS styles that are generating the style here in the navigation area. So first up, I want to change the size to make it a little bit larger so we can read it a little bit better. So I'll turn it from 13 pixels to 16 pixels to make it a little bit larger. Also, I want to change the font style from this Open Sans font to the same font we're using here for this title. So down below, I'm going to pop in the new font family, and I'm going to call that Dosis. That's what we've been using. And it looks like this is still a little bit small, so I'm going to make it even bigger. Let's try 22 pixels. Okay, that looks pretty good. Last, I want to change the color from this gray color to a black color to match my logo. So here where it says color, I'm going to change it from the #93 number to #all zeros, like so. Okay, awesome. So that looks really good. So last but not least, I'm just going to highlight all of this, highlight it and copy it. So I'm going to copy all of this code right here, highlight it and copy it. Then I'm going to close this box, go back to my dashboard by clicking on Dashboard, go down to Appearance, and then click on Editor. And then at the bottom, as we did previously, I'm going to paste in the new code that we just copied in the previous step. Also note that the font size I put was 22 pixels, but I think I'll make that a little bit smaller. I'll make it 20 pixels instead. We didn't change text transform or the font weight, so I'm going to remove that altogether. And that looks good to go. And then last but not least, just to make sure that this is displayed on the homepage, I'm going to add these important tags. It's not always necessary, I should say, to add the important tags, but sometimes the parent theme will override the child theme. So just to make sure that doesn't happen now, I'm just going to add these important tags. Okay, then I'm going to click on Update File to update my file. Now let's check it out by going up to the top and clicking on Visit Site. Okay, great. Now we can see our new font styles being reflected here on the left-hand sidebar. Note that when I hover over these menu items, it's a gray font on a teal background, which makes the font and the text a little bit hard to read. So I want to make that a little bit darker. I want to turn that black. So to change the font color once again, lastly, I'm going to hold down the Control key on my Mac, click my mouse, open up Inspect Elements. We're going to change this gray font to a black font. So once again, here is the code on the left-hand side and the CSS styles on the right. To find the hover color, I'm going to hover over this HTML code here, hold down the Control key on my Mac, and open up this box, which will have a force element state, and I want to force the element state to the hover state. Then we'll get this CSS code here on the right-hand side, and we can adjust the color from gray to black. So here's the CSS right here. We actually had changed this previously in the video, so it's already in our style sheet. So I just need to go find it, and I just want to change the color from this #93 number, which is gray, to black. So I'm going to close this right here, go back to the dashboard by clicking on Dashboard, go down to Appearance and Editor, and here we see the code right here with the hover code and the color. So I just want to change that color to black by overriding the 93 number to make it all zeros. Okay, so this will turn it black. Then I'll click on Update File, and now we go back to the homepage by going up to the top and clicking on Visit Site. Now we'll see on the left-hand side, when I hover on top of each one of these items, now we can more easily see the menu item because it's black on a teal background. So we're almost done with this beautiful WordPress website. We have two more things to do. Number one, we need to create some blog posts, and number two, we need to create some call to action buttons. So starting with the blog post, to create a new blog post, you can either go up to the top, hover over plus new, and click on post, or you can go to the dashboard by clicking on dashboard. Then on the left-hand sidebar, you can go down to post, hover over post, and click on add new. Here on the new blog post page, first up, we need to give our new blog post a title. So I'm going to pop in my title right there, and then here in the white box, this is where you can add your content. Note that there's a visual tab as well as a text tab. The visual tab is the what you see is what you get view of WordPress. This is where you can just post the content that you have in this white box. Then you can use these formatting icons up above to format it. So if I want to format this, I would just highlight it and click on the B here to bold it. Or if I want to italicize it, I can click on this button. There's all these different formatting icons that you can use to format your posts. The good news is with WordPress, you don't need to know any code. If you'd like to check out the code that's being generated behind the scenes, however, by WordPress, you can do so by clicking on the text tab right here. Here we'll see the HTML code that is being generated behind the scenes in order to create the formatting for the website. Again, the good news is that with WordPress, you don't need to know the code, but this is a really helpful way to learn HTML if you'd like to learn it by toggling back and forth between these two tabs. Personally, I prefer to stay within the visual tab, so I'm just going to click on visual right here. And once you've added content to your post, then you just want to scroll down and give your new blog post a category. So I might just want to add a new category by clicking on add new category. Then I'll add my category name. And once you've given your category a name, go ahead and click on Add New Category to create your new category. Then down below, you can add tags if you like, making sure that you separate your tags with a comma. Once you've added your tags, go ahead and click on Add to create your new tags. Then down below, here where it says Featured Image, I'm going to choose an image by clicking on Set Featured Image. Then to upload the image, I'm going to click on Upload Files, Select Files. Then I'll select my file, click on open, and once the image has been uploaded to WordPress, I'm going to give my new image a title and an alternative text. Once I've added the title and alternative text, I can add the image by clicking on set featured image. Once the image has been added, if you've added that magic action box previously in the video, then you can just select whatever action box you would like to have displayed. Then I'm going to go up to the top and click on publish to publish my new post. So in the essence of time, I'm going to repeat the steps that we've just done to create this blog post, and I'm going to create a few additional posts behind the scenes. I'll see you on the other side once I've created those additional blog posts. So back on the homepage of our WordPress website, I just finished adding some additional blog posts to the website following the steps in the previous example. Let's take a look. When I click on blog, here we'll arrive at the blog archive page. At the top, we'll have our slider, the title, and our call to action button. Then down below, we'll have our blog grid layout. This is the blog archive page with all of our blog posts listed. Also note that if you want to continue to more blog posts, you can do so by simply clicking on next. So let's take a look at one of these blog posts. When I click on this one, for example, at the top, we'll have our header image, our title, and then this is the actual blog post. Pretty cool. Okay, so now that we have our blog posts added to our website, last up, we want to add some call to action buttons to our website. And what we're going for is this finished look over here. Hopping over to the finished site, I'm going to click on services. And here we'll see at the bottom of our services page, we have this really cool customized button, call to action button, which when we click on this to get started, it will lead to the contact page. So it's always a good idea to add call to action buttons or call to action links on every page of your WordPress website. So let's go about adding that call to action button now. We're going to be using the Max Buttons WordPress button plugin right here. So to add this to our website, we're going to go back to our website here, go to the dashboard by clicking on dashboard. Then I'm going to go down to plugins, hover over plugins, and click on add new. Here within the WordPress plugin library, I'm going to do a search for Max Buttons. And here we see it's on the left-hand side. This has a really great rating with 50,000 active installs and close to a 5-star rating. It was last updated 12 hours ago. So this is a super awesome button plugin for WordPress. So to install it, I'm going to click on Install Now. And once the plugin has been successfully installed, I'm going to click on Activate Plugin to activate the plugin. Okay, so once a plugin has been activated, we'll see it down below right here where it says Max Buttons, and you'll also see it on your sidebar down below here where it says Max Buttons. When I hover over Max Buttons, you'll see there's a number of additional options right here. So I'm going to start with Settings by clicking on Settings. So the Settings tab is pretty self-explanatory. These are the settings for the Max Button plugin, and you can set them right here. I'm going to go with all the defaults, so I'm not going to change anything right here, but I just want to point out that if you'd like to read through all of these settings, you can do so by clicking on the Settings tab. The one that we really want, though, is this Button tab over here, so I'm going to click on Buttons, and this is where we can create our first button. So to do that, I'm going to click on Add New to create a new button. Then first up, we need to give our new button a name. Here it says name, add something that you can quickly identify the button with. This is for your own benefit, not really for the button itself, but just so that you know what the button is about. So I'm going to call this CTA, it's a call to action, and I'll call it Get Started. If you'd like to add a brief description to remind yourself what this is about, you can do so by adding a description here. I'm not going to do that. Instead, I'm going to scroll down. Here where it says URL, this is the link where the button is clicked, so this is a really important one to add, so I'll add the URL right here. Next, if you'd like to open the link in a new window, you can click on this box here. I'm not going to check that, however, I'll leave that unchecked. Next up, if you'd like to adjust the dimensions of the width, you can do so here. I'm not going to do that. I'm going to leave the defaults. However, here where we have the text settings, we can adjust the settings right here. So I'm going to change the font from Arial default font to Verdana. So I'll click on that. And we also need to add the actual button words that appear on the button. So here where it says button, by default, we want to add our actual words for this button. So I'll call my button Let's Get Started. Also note that there's a preview box over here on the right-hand side to see what the button is looking like in the preview. Okay, scrolling down, if you'd like to text align it, I'd like to do that, so I'll make it center aligned. And then everything else I'm going to leave as it is. Then scrolling down here for the colors, this is where I'm going to change the colors. So for the text, for example, I want this to be the teal color, so I'm going to click on that. Here I will add the number because I happen to know the number, but if you don't know the number of the text. You can simply scroll around here like any of these color panels and choose whatever color you would like. Okay, I'm gonna go with the teal color, so I'll just pop that in. Then for the text shadow, I don't want any text shadow, so I will keep this white. Pretty much all the stuff I want to keep white except for the border. So go ahead and add whatever colors you'd like here in the color section. Once you've designed the button as you would like it to have displayed and you see that you like it here on the preview panel, go ahead and save your button by scrolling up to the top and clicking on save. Then once the button has been saved, here you'll note that there's a short code. So we want to grab this max button short code right here by highlighting it and copying it. Then we want to go to the page where we want to display this and paste that short code. So I want to add this on the services page. So I'm going to go to pages over here on the left-hand side, hover over pages and click on all pages. Then I'm going to go down to the services page here and click on edit. And then I'm going to scroll down to the bottom of the page and I'm going to paste this short code where I want that button to be displayed. Then I'm going to click on update to update my page. So now when we go to our page and we check it out by clicking on view page, now we see when we scroll to the bottom of the page, we have this really cool customized call to action button that leads to the contact page. Now keep in mind, we haven't yet created a contact page, so we do need to do that before we click on this. Otherwise, we're going to have an error page. So really quick, I'm going to create a contact page for our WordPress website by going up to the top, hovering over plus new, and clicking on page. Here on the new page, I'm gonna give my new page a title. I'll call this contact. And then here, because we've previously added the Jetpack plugin, we already have this button here at the top that says add a contact form. So I'm gonna click on this button, and here we have a preview of what our form will look like. So that looks really good. So I'm just gonna click on add this form to my post. And then I'm gonna scroll down, check it out. Everything else looks good. Then I'm just gonna click on publish to publish my new contact page. Once a page has been published, now I can check it out by clicking on view page, and voila, here we have our contact page. Pretty cool. So now when we go to services once again to check out that button, we click on services, scroll to the bottom. Here's our really cool customized call to action button, which when I click on it, it will go directly to the contact page. Awesome. So earlier in this video, I mentioned this website is responsive, which means it will look amazing on all kinds of screen sizes, including iPhones, iPads, tablets, laptops, and desktops. Let's take a quick look at the responsiveness though, because there is one styling customization that we need to make so that we can see all the words in the responsive view. For example, when I come to the bottom of the screen here and I reduce the screen size, everything looks really good so far. However, when we come to this kind of view right here, this is what we would see on an iPhone, for example, or a smartphone. We note that the menu here is, the lines are no longer visible because once again, it's white on white, and our website name is also white on white. So we need to make an adjustment here so that we can see what the website name is here. This has to be dark on white, and we need to see this. So once again, using the Google Chrome browser, I'm going to hold down the control key on my Mac, click on the mouse, and then I'm going to click on Inspect Elements. This will bring up the code which we'll need in order to make the adjustment to that menu toggle area. So for example, when I scroll down right here, here we can see the code that is generating the HTML here for this area. And on the right hand side, here we see the CSS styles. So when I scroll down, we'll see that this icon bar, the background color is currently white, and that is why we cannot see it. So let's see what happens when we adjust this from white to black. Okay, there we go. So when we change the icon bar background color to black, now we can see these three lines. Awesome. So I'm going to copy this, highlight it and copy it. And as we did previously, I'm going to add it to my child theme style sheet by closing this box. Then I'll just open this briefly so we can see it a little bit better. Go to the desktop by clicking on desktop. Then I'm going to go down to appearance and editor, and I'm going to paste the code that I just copied in the previous step. Okay, and then I'll click on update file. So now when we go back to the site by going up to the top and clicking on visit site, and now when I reduce the screen size back to that smartphone version, now we can see these three lines. Awesome. So last but not least, we have our website title here. We need to do the same thing. So on the Mac, I'm going to hold down the control key, click on my mouse, open up Inspect Elements. We get to go really fast now because we've done this so many times. Okay, so here it is right here, the A class, and this is MK Mobile Branding. So here on the right-hand side, we can see the color is white. We're going to change that to black, which are 6 zeros. And now we can see it here on the left-hand side. Awesome. So I'm just going to grab this once again, highlight it and copy it. Close the Inspect Elements box and go back to the dashboard by clicking on Dashboard. Then go down to Appearance and Editor. And I'm going to drop that code that I just copied in the previous step, making sure I close it off with a closing bracket. And I will remove the code that I didn't touch. So the only thing I'm adding here is the color, and it's going to be black. Okay, cool. So then I'll just add the important tag to make sure that is showing up. And at the end, I'm going to click on Update File to update my file. So now, drum roll, once we go back to the site by clicking on Visit Site, and when we reduce the screen size, going back to the mobile view, voila, now everything looks really awesome in the responsive view. This is the iPhone or smartphone view. We can see the website title right here, and here is the menu area, which when I click on these lines, then I get my drop-down box of all our various items. Note that it's pretty obvious these days. People know when you click on the website name, that is the home. So you really don't need to have this home link right here. I might want to just remove that and also add the contact page in its place. So going back to the menus, I'm going to go directly to the menus by clicking on menus. And I'll open this up so we can see it just a little bit easier. I'm going to remove the home one because we really don't need that. Click on remove. And I'm going to add the contact one by clicking on contact and clicking on add to menu. Then I'm going to click on save menu to save my menu. So now I'm going to go back to the site by clicking on visit site.
Now on the homepage for our menu navigation, we have a much more efficient navigation because the logo or the title of the website acts as the home link as well. Then we have our various internal pages that we can navigate to, the about page, services page, blog page, and contact page. We have our social icons at the bottom and we have our search box. So you can just click on this and you can search for anything within the website. So if you've made it this far, congratulations, because you should have a really awesome looking website that looks something like this. To review the website we've created in this video, in addition to the menu navigation here on the left-hand side, here on the homepage, we've added a background image along with a tagline that will give our visitors a really clear understanding what our website and our business is all about. We've also added a clear call to action button to guide our visitors to the next step. And on the homepage, underneath this banner image, we have an email opt-in form to start capturing leads directly from our homepage. Then, taking a look at some of the internal pages we've created in this video, here at the top we have the About page, and each of the internal pages will feature an image, so we've added that in this video, along with some content, and at the bottom we have, once again, a call to action button. Then we have our services page, so we've added that within this video tutorial. And we have two more pages we've added, a blog page, which at the top features once again our banner image and our tagline and a call to action. And then for the blog page, we've also added in this video tutorial these various thumbnail images which lead directly to the various blog posts. Pretty cool. Then finally, last but not least, in this video tutorial, we've added a contact page so our visitors can easily contact us from within our website. So this is what we created in this video tutorial. If you've made it this far, congratulations. You should have a really cool website that looks like this. I hope this video was helpful to you. If it was, feel free to leave me a comment below, like this video, and share this video with your friends. I will be coming out with more videos related to WordPress and how to build your online business. So please subscribe to my YouTube channel. Until next time, keep learning new skills, and I'll see you in the next video.